Good morning. It's time for services here on the 29th of November, our second Sunday of our second wave of closings. And we still have number 3 and number 4 closed ahead of us. And if you're not getting any better, any quicker than I am, we're going to need that time. Roger is much better, out doing errands, of course, staying quarantined, but doing errands right here at the farm. And I don't mean going out and doing major errands. I mean taking out scraps and small little things. I know that I've finally gotten to the place I can go cook one thing for us. I'm really thankful that I have not been critically ill, but I've had enough illness to really be weak and to have needed this 2 weeks desperately. I go from wanting to do something to wanting to sit down or to take a nap. So in this condition, I'm not sure what kind of a program. You may say, well, you really aren't, you're not able to give us much this morning. But my heart and my mind have been working. And there are some things that are on my mind. I'm going to go back through the archives and get songs from the church. And I would like to start with a thought I got from John Maxwell this week. He was talking about the times in our life when we get stuck. And I think that word came to him because it's one of the words on almost everybody's mind right now, isn't it? I'm stuck. He said, you know, it's better to be stuck than to be sliding back. But if you're stuck, you just can't seem to go forward. You're stuck. How do you get unstuck? Have you ever been stuck? Just caught by something and you can't seem to move forward? Have you ever gotten a lawnmower stuck by mowing where it was too wet and then the lawnmower bogged down and you just had kind of a wet soup underneath the tires and it was just spinning and you could do nothing but turn it off and wait for help to drag you out of there? Have you ever been stuck financially? That it just seemed you could not get ahead a penny? That can be answered by paying your tithes and then giving an offering above that in faith. That will take care of that. Have you ever been stuck in a relationship? And you had to stop and really put some time in on prayer and scripture and asking yourself, am I the one that's stuck? Is the other person stuck? Is this a relationship that the time for it is past and the Lord is just sending us in different directions? Or is this a relationship that I need to really reach out across the absence and I need to think about how will I do unto this person as I would have them do unto me and get unstuck? Have you ever been stuck spiritually? When you get stuck spiritually, you have to go on your knees, humble in your heart, mind, and soul before the throne, and you have to really pour out your heart and admit through Jesus' name, through the Holy Spirit being with you, to God Almighty that I'm stuck, Lord. I'm stuck. I'm at a place I need to move. I've been here too many months, too many years. I need to move. Would you help me get unstuck? And the Lord will. He'll come. He'll send help. He'll send wisdom. He'll send guidance. And you'll be able to get unstuck. Today, I think we're all thinking, I'm stuck. Kind of like the little hamster on the wheel. We just can't seem to get well. well enough to really feel like staying up all day, really well enough to do the things we always do. I spend a lot of time in study and in communication to the church, and I've just not been able for that. But I'm thankful that I have been unstuck enough that I'm out of the bed and starting to do one thing at a time. This whole situation we're in, we're stuck in, aren't we? We need to spend some time praying earnestly, Lord, unstick us. Your people need you ahead of us. We need to look down and see you are the light to our next footstep. You are the path to our next place to go. Work with us. Help us hunger and thirst to be right with you. Lord, we want to be unstuck spiritually so we can move on in you. This would be our will and our request for each of us in your kingdom today.
Here I am to work.
we blessed with great singing at our church. A lot of churches are blessed with great people who sing. We are blessed with people who work all the different jobs around the church. Jobs that you never see getting done. It doesn't matter if we see them or not, God does. There's a scripture that I was reading today about the fact that God sees all. It's in Proverbs 15:3. It says that, you know, that God sees everything. Now, you and I, we're in one place at a time. Jesus, when he was here on earth, was in one place at a time. Even the angels, it seems, can only be in one place at a time, because when Daniel needed Michael to come and bring the message, he said, "I've been up there fighting the evil forces, and I had to get that done before I could bring the message. The answer was on the way from day one, but I had to fight my way here. It took 21 days. But God is present everywhere. He sees every one of us. He knows your need. He knows my need. He knows exactly what's going on in us, in our family, in our church. When I think of the amount of work that we were doing, we had to have a target on our back for Satan to have a go at us. Because everywhere you looked, someone was doing a job. Whether that was fixing the Sunday school bags, or buying the treats or the things to go in them, or whether that was getting ready for the community outreach, whether or not that was preparing for jam or working on the worship team or doing the bulletin or discussing with each other and praying with each other for those that were in need that we knew of. There's just such a wonderful look at how busy. It would be almost like if you could peel that back and look from heaven, you would have almost seen like a ants moving of how much we were working for the Lord. I believe we still are. Many of you have contacted me and asked how I am. I've tried to contact a few of you. Not like I usually do, but I've tried to check and stay in touch. We are the church. And you know, I've read this thing this week that said, together is the greatest gift that can ever be given. Together. And I'm sure a lot of us found that out. Found that out yesterday, Thursday, when our family couldn't meet. All these generations we've had Thanksgiving until this one. And this one we had to limp through, didn't we? Many of us. We couldn't be together with our families. The Lord sees you. He knows your need. He sees your family, your life, your soul, and he knows your need. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, it is in your name that we come before the throne. We come, Lord, just asking that you would just go from person to person to person to person, that you, Holy Spirit, would just do that same thing, and that the conversations would move up there to heaven, and Lord Jesus, you would be the advocate, and Holy Spirit, you would take the message and then bring it back to the person, and you, Almighty God, would look to the issues that are going on within the congregation and the outreach of the congregation. And Lord, of those who join us on live stream or on the radio, on Facebook, on the website, any way that it's shared, Lord, We ask that you would send forth the Spirit to help people recognize how active you want to be in their lives, how much you love them, how much you care. Speak, Lord, from the youngest to the eldest, and help them. Help them, Lord, have more faith in you than they have ever had in you. In times like these, we need a Savior. Help us to grasp that thought and hang on to it with every bit of our being. In times like these, we need a Savior. We pray this, Lord, in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Person, we would be lighting the Advent candle for hope. And we would be looking down the road between here and Christmas at the hope there is in Christ. Had you lived in the days between the Testament, if you had lived from Malachi the 400 years down until Christ is born, you would have been living in a time when hope was about all you had. The Roman Empire and the armies were marching the streets of Israel. Israel was in a desperate condition. I think probably this year and what we've been through is about the only thing that comes close to letting us understand what it might have been like to have been in Israel when the history of Israel and its disobedience had brought it to a place where it was no longer the apple of God's eye, but it was rather a place that God had brought judgment on. He had sent advice through the prophets. They had ignored them. He had sent advice so many different ways, and they simply would not obey. He had let Assyria come and get those top 10 tribes and carry them off. Later, let Babylon come and destroy Jerusalem and carry off the tribes from there. But because of his promise, to Judah, because of his promise that Jesus Christ would come out of the tribe of Judah, and because he promised that if they would recognize and call upon him, that he would bring them back and restore them. When Nehemiah and Ezra and some of the people in the Persian Empire at this time started calling upon God and started having broken hearts over the condition of Jerusalem and the temple, God had brought them back. And they had rebuilt some of Jerusalem, but they were still under siege, and people were still disobedient, and things were bad. Even after Nehemiah had helped them cleanse and rebuild, when he had to go back to serve his king and came back again to Jerusalem, he found they had even moved the enemy right into the priest's rooms and allowed that enemy to be right, living right in the house and doing wrong things in the house of God. It was a hard time. It's very much parallels America today, that we no longer go by the Bible. We no longer teach a way, a truth, a life, but rather we have become people that are not defined by this word of God. And now we have a pandemic, a pestilence among us. We have a germ that has come in and has just simply scrambled the hopes of so many. It has added to the deterioration of the home by causing people to have to remain separated. It has caused many elderly person to have to be separated and live and die alone because of the rules concerning this. It has caused many to go to the hospital alone and live through all of those times in there alone because of the pandemic. It has separated friends and families. It has separated the church. We need a hope. In the days of Israel, their hope was that Jesus Christ, the Messiah, would come. And certainly, when the time was right, Gabriel was dispatched down to Zacharias and Elizabeth, and then down to Mary, and later to Joseph, and the boys that would, one to make the path straight, and the other one that was the truth, the way, and the light, would come into this world, and hope was born. Hope was born. And now in this day, we live in a day when not only hope has been born, but Jesus lived. He taught, he preached, he healed, he had command of everything on this earth. He faced death and Satan on our behalf and won. He took away the curse of death that we live under because we're in frail bodies. He took away that curse that we bargained for in the garden. When he died on the cross, if we receive his blood to wash away our sins, then we are no longer under the curse of death. When the bodies die, the spirit goes to be with God. And the second death will have no power when the time comes that sin will cause people to be cast into the lake of fire. We will have no sin. So we again will go live with the Father. Hope. Our hope is in Jesus Christ. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. Romans 15. Let every one of us please his neighbor for his good to edification. Is there somebody you can help get unstuck? Is there someone you haven't talked to for a while that you could call? For even Christ pleased not himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of them that reproached thee fell on me. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Now, the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another, according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore, receive ye one another, as Christ also received us to the glory of God. Take some time and reach out and actually help get people unstuck. Encourage them. Say good things to them. Find a way. Ask the Holy Spirit. Ask Jesus to help you be an instrument of encouragement to others. Now, I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. He came to confirm the promises and that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, for this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name. And again he saith, rejoice ye Gentiles with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all ye Gentiles, and laud him, all ye people. Let's be a people of celebration. Let's be a people that continually tell about the hope that is within us. This too will pass. We have the hope of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. I'm closing today with some footage from Nipshin Camp with the Lohr family. Have a great Sunday. Call someone and tell them they can watch the services today by going to Facebook, Wilma Irwin, Facebook, Maysville Church of Christ and Christian Union, or to the webpage, maysville3cu.org. Have a great and blessed day as you enjoy the Lohrs. And after the Lohrs, I'm going to close with a song from Sister Carrie. And it talks about in the garden, being in the garden with Jesus. Let your mind go to that kind of a week that you're going to walk with Christ this week. God bless you. Strong.